Hi there, I'm Andrew Brown. Welcome to Real-Time Music and Sound with Pure Data. In this video, we're going to be looking at smoothing data with the line object. There's a number of circumstances in which smoothing of data is used in audio systems. In this diagram, you can see some of those. In audio systems, sometimes moving smoothly from one value to another over time is called the slew, or the slew time is how long it takes. Other times it's called gliding between values. In envelopes, it's often called, attack or decay, those kinds of things. There's a whole other video in this series on envelopes, so we won't be covering amplitude envelopes in this. In computer graphics in particular, or animation, there's this notion of easing in and easing out to have a non-linear time. And then, of course, in acoustic music, we've got this notion of a glissandi between different pitches, or a crescendo or a decrescendo in the volume space. So it's these kinds of smoothings that we're going to be looking at. The object we're going to focus on today is the line object in PD, in order to do some of those and to see how versatile it can be. So let's get started. We need, since as always, to start with a sound generating source. So I'll create an oscillator. Make sure that we've got a master volume control and a digital audio converter as an output. We'll add a volume control in the form of a number box, values from 0 to 1, give it a label so I remember what it is. So there's our sound. Okay, so that's our oscillator. So the first parameter in our audio system we're going to focus on for smoothing data out is in the pitch domain. So we're going to change the pitch of this oscillator. So in order to do that, of course, we know that we can just simply change the frequency, for example, using this number box. So that's all fine. But if we're playing from a MIDI keyboard or something, we're more likely to get MIDI pitches coming in. So we would use, in that case, a MIDI to frequency object to turn a MIDI pitch into that. So that I don't have to sit here playing, I'm going to automate this process with a metronome to generate some data. So we've got our toggle, metronome, go every 1,000. That's all good. Then I will get a random number pitch generated over 3 octaves, then offset that by a little bit so we get things within the middle of the pitch range. That'll go to frequency and that should turn the volume up. Okay, so we've got these abrupt changes in pitch, and our task in a sense will be to make those pitch shifts a little bit smoother than what they currently are. Before I get to that though, I want to be able to make sure we can visualize, not just hear this change, so I'm going to take a little bit of time to create an array so that we can see that as a kind of visualization. I'll call this maybe raw data, make it 500 big, and there's our raw data array. Values by default for these arrays go between 0 and 1, and because this is MIDI pitch, I need it to go from 127 down to 0, which is the MIDI pitch range. And to write to that, first of all, I'm just going to use a float box to store the data, which we'll need later. Use tab right, and we're going to write to the raw data array. So far, so good. I'm going to, that's the value which is going to come in here from our pitch into that raw data there. We need to put something in the right inlet to make it so that we can scan across our array as we go. I want this to kind of animate in real time, so it's going to look a little bit more complicated than you might expect. But anyway, we're going to use another float to store a value, which is going to go into our position, and we need to increment that over time. So we put a counter in, we're going to increment that by one. We need to make sure that that loops back after it's finished. So we specify modulo the length of the array, put that back in. If in the future I want to reset that, I'm going to put a number box to zero so I can reset that counter. Now, how is this counter going to go? Well, ironically, we're going to actually use a line object to make this work as well. So a line object in PD generates a ramp from one number, of whatever the current value is, to another number over a certain period of time. So in this case, the message that we're going to pass to the line, you always need to pass it a message box, is that we're going to go to that number over the 500, because that's the length of our array. So we just go to there, put that into our float. And what else do we need to do? We need to bang that. So, oops, and actually, no, mistake, that's got to be over a second because that's the timing of our metronome. Okay, so this line object is going to send out a series of values between 0 and 1,000. So it's going to take a second to do its ramp. What we need to do is our floats need to be banged. Excuse me. So we'll need to make sure that that's sending out bangs very frequently as it's doing. So then we can bang that float and we can bang this float. It's all good. So now you can see in our graph that the pitch values which we're generating, we're getting a quick change to the new pitch, and then it holds at that pitch until the next metronome click. We can listen to that as well. Okay, so we're just visualizing that so that when we do our line ramps, we'll be able to visualize the difference that that does. So let's see if we can make that work in audio first. So we're getting this pitch, and what we need to do is use a line object to ramp from the previous pitch to the next pitch. Like all line objects, we need to pass it a value, and in this case it's going to be a variable, which is the pitch it's going to be passed in, and then we need a time for that ramp. Given that we've got 1 second between onsets, let's say it takes half of that time to ramp up or down. We can connect that in, turn the volume up. Oops, connect the line. So we can hear that that's doing the glissandi between the different pitches. Turn that down for a second. Now let's see if we can visualize what that's doing. Just copying that, getting some errors while I've got it doubled. Let's change its name. I also need to then write to that. This one's going to write to the line data array. And so that will be the output of our line will go into here. That is also going to be triggered by there, and the count is going to go, oops, my mistake, goes into that left inlet. That float will go to there. Okay, so both of our arrays are being written. The difference is that the first one has the raw values from the MIDI pitch, and the one below has the line data, the ramped data from the line. And as you can see, we can visualize that whenever there's a new one, instead of jumping straight to that value, we go there over time. So we can change this 500 to some other value. If I make it 100, it'll be much faster. Change. Okay, so at this point, if you listen carefully when there's a large jump from one pitch to another, you can hear that it's actually doing some quantizing of those pitches on that line on the way down. So this is a more subtle issue with the line object. By default, the line object recomputes its position in that line every 20 milliseconds. However, it's still not fast enough for our ears to not hear some of those glides. So I'll put some arguments in, an initial value of 0, and set that recompute value to 1 millisecond, and that should smooth that out much more. So now you can hear that even when we get a big jump, we're getting a much smoother glissando, because the line's operating at a much faster rate. And of course we can slow that down. Okay, and let's turn the volume down, and that's good. So we've got the line to control our pitch. The other thing that we may want to control is our volume. If I turn this volume up and down quite rapidly, you can occasionally hear some clicks in that signal. Let me just do that for a sec. Okay, so those clicks in the signal are often referred to as zipper noise, and it's a similar problem that we need to smooth these values which are coming, because we're getting some abrupt jumps in the volume level, and that's causing clicks in our volume thing, and it's called zipper noise. So we could similarly use the line object as we've done here, but because this is an audio signal, we'll get a smoother result if we use the audio version of the line, which is line tilde. Otherwise operates quite similarly. We can pass it in the new value and some quite short duration, 20 milliseconds ramp. Then when I do the same kind of rapid increase and decrease, you'll hear that we've got a very smooth change. So that's all very good for that. The next kind of audio parameter which we might want to look at smoothing is some kind of filter cutoff. Now, in one sense, it doesn't really make a lot of sense to add a filter to an oscillator. However, if we put a filter in, even though we may not be doing it, we will still hear the artifacts that we need to get rid of. In fact, possibly more clearly with a sine wave than with a rich signal, where the upper harmonics could mess with our hearing of clicks and things. So if I put in the low frequency, an low pass filter, and push it through, then I can use possibly maybe I put a slider in. Might make it a little smaller. Now the values for our filter, let's say we go from 0 up to 20,000. We might want to make that a logarithmic change. And this is our cutoff. Okay. So that's into our filter. Turn our volume up. Again, if I move this quite quickly, you will hear, if you listen carefully, that there are some clicks in that. So again, we've got the zipper noise that we had with the audio. So if we were to use the same solution that we applied for line for the audio, and try and use a nice smooth audio line, the issue is going to be that this low pass filter cutoff value doesn't accept an audio signal. It only accepts data signals. So, okay, we can say that's fine. Let's just use the normal line one. Instead, we get the value. Just give it a small increment of change. Put that in and have a listen. So, unfortunately, that's still got a bit of zipper noise in it. We're still getting some clicks. So we could use the trick that we used earlier, which is to speed up that line. So let's turn the volume up. And that's actually pretty good. I expect that if you're listening to the compressed audio on YouTube for this, you possibly didn't hear any clicks in there at all, but I can assure you that if you were able to do this on your own and listen very carefully, there are still some artifacts. But this is a pretty good solution, but it's not a perfect solution in that regard. So what we could do instead in this case is we could change the filter and instead use a VCF filter that requires an argument for resonance, and the low pass comes out that outlet. And the good thing about this particular filter is that it does accept an audio signal for the cutoff amount, so we can use our audio line. Turn the volume up. And as we increase and decrease the cutoff rapidly, we have a very smooth transition because we're operating that ramp at audio rate. So that shows us that we can use this line to smooth things in the frequency domain, in the audio domain, in the filter cutoff domain, and in fact in any other domain. And it will provide us with ramps rather than abrupt changes in those things. And that can be particularly useful. I will just finish by saying it's especially useful in the case where you're controlling things externally from a MIDI controller. So if, for example, you've got the control in and using a MIDI controller of some value, whatever your MIDI controller is, and you're doing that, then of course this is between 0 and 127. So what you would want to do is to make sure you divide by 127, but you've still got 127 steps, and you can imagine that with those steps you may hear the kind of stepping that we had as zipper noise problems. But if you put it through this process of smoothing it with a line, then you'll actually be fine, even if you're using an external MIDI controller. So it's good practice to do that on any of these parameters for frequency, for filter cutoff, or for amplitude, whenever you're controlling those things from some external MIDI controller. Okay, that's enough for today. Have fun implementing that, and I'll see you in another video.